Good morning, church. It's really good to be with you again. This is the last session of our time together. I'm not sure if the worship that we have earlier on is your normal kind of a worship that you have every Sunday. But this is how I felt standing there with you. I felt that God has just done something and that He has. I heard a sound click. That's all I heard during the worship time. I heard a sound click. It was as if that God was trying to opening up a treasure chest. And He came to a point where He slowed it down. And then suddenly you hear the sound click. What that means could be at a church level. It could be at an individual person's level. So I want those of us who really have a sense that God has put something that is clicked in your heart, not to neglect that click, but to pay attention to that click that God has done in your inner man. And as a church leadership, for those of you who have been with me in the last 2 days, if you too in the church leadership sense that God has done something that click in your hearts for the church, then I pray that you will not neglect that. And you pay attention to what God is trying to do as He clicks something for you as a church level. I'm grateful to God for the opportunity to be with you over this weekend. This topic is actually a 20-hour topic. To put them all in together in the condensed version, it's very rich, and I could tell last night when I went back home, a lot of energy came out of me. I remember I just fell flat. And But it's I think God really is trying to say something to us. And I pray that we have ears to listen. What I'm going to do this morning, in the last session, is to take everything in together and put it together as one message for all of us, so that those of us who didn't attend can catch up with us, and then we'll move on from that point onwards. I started off by talking about the fuel, the passion, the energy and the drive to keep on going out into the nations, to keep on going out into the different aspect of what God has called us to do, must come from my commitment to love God with all of my heart, soul, mind and strength. That the energy and the passion to keep going out there into the nations must come from the commitment to love God with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength. Now, I've been as a missionary with YWAM. This is my 20th year in missions. And 20th year doing the same job. I thoroughly enjoy what I do simply because as I grow deeper in my walk with God, then God allows me to explore many of the different environments and the nations and the situations that I get to go to. One of my biggest highlights last year was to receive a call to go to Tajikistan. And when I first heard of Tajikistan, of course, the first question is, huh? Like, where is Tajikistan? And then you have to go and find in a map. Now, in our YWAM International Gathering, very often, we have a wall map that's laid on the floor that's about double the size of this hall. Wall map. Now, you can stand on Singapore. That tells you how big the wall map is. Right? If you can stand on Singapore, it means it's quite big. And we were having our international YWAM meeting, and someone from the Stans nation, he used to work in Afghanistan, and he came up to me, I've never met him before, came up to me and grabbed me by my hand and walked me all the way to Tajikistan. He stood in front of Tajikistan. He said to me, "Can you please come?" I looked around at me. "Okay, can you please come?" Now, at a sudden, I suddenly realized as a Singaporean, we have this kiasi. You're afraid of danger. And every time when the word a stun is mentioned, immediately you think of all the terror that you could think about. And that flashed up in front of me, and I realized that I had to first overcome the fear of death, the fear of my own prejudices and my own perception of danger zones within there. And immediately, we had a time of prayer and reconciliation within my own heart. And the following year, I followed up with him, and that's how I ended up in Tajikistan. You know, when you're invited into such a situation, why would you not want to do missions? Why would you want to quit? Now, so many times when I was offered jobs throughout this last 20 years, I could not say yes, simply because I recognized the value of that song that Sean was leading us, the Alabaster Jar, that God is worthy of my everything and I will not turn back. So the passion, the ability to keep saying yes to God comes from me loving God with all of my heart, soul, mind and strength. And when we look into the Great Commission, when we talk about the Great Commission, we look into the full version of the Great Commission. So I said to us that the Great Commission consists of three strands, just like the way that you want to plait your hair. You cannot take one strand and say, I like this and I don't like this too. No, you can't. Because the Great Commission consists of three strands all woven together as one. The first one is Mark 16:15. What it says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation, i.e. every human being. Why? Because human beings are made in the image of God. Human beings are made in the image of God. So when God made John in your mother's womb, God was woving John together and God has thoughts towards John within there. But when God was making John, who was he looking at? Himself. So God looked at himself and he made you and he made me. All of us carry an image of God, therefore we have value. You have value because you and I are made in the image of God. The reason why God so loved the world, because he made the world in his image, i.e. even prostitutes, even drug addicts, even people who are wicked and terror, every single one of them are made in the image of God. Yes, most of us deem that some of these people are not deserving to receive the good news. But you know what? God sees them differently. Precisely because they are not deserving, they qualify. They qualify. And so is every one of us. Do you and I think that we are more deserving than the rest? No, we don't. And simply because of that, we receive grace. But more than that, God so loved the world. Therefore, Jesus says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every human being because they are made in the image of God. A second scripture that is important, that is the Matthew 28 passage that says, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you always. This scripture, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, has got to do with ethnic groups, i.e. people groups, tribes, communities, kampong, district. So we are talking about not individual persons now, we are talking about going there and change a kampong, change a community. Now, as you step into a village in Cambodia, as you step into a village in Nepal, as you step into the village in China, one of the biggest issues about China is this issue about some of the societies that you go into. Like, for example, I was in one of the city in Yunnan province. The whole city wiped out because of AIDS. I've never seen this in my life before. And it's basically a sense of immorality that actually practiced within the particular kampong, the district where they are lived in. And God says, go into the city and make disciples out of them. Change the texture of the villages. Look at where things do not flow like God. Step into there and change the texture. Change the culture. Where you have got kampongs that are self-destructing, whether is it lack of education or lack of knowledge to healthcare, go into those kampongs and introduce a God-like form of healthcare. Introduce how God would do education. Introduce how God values women. There are many, many locations. There are many, many villages here. As you look into some of these nations that you go into, and it says a strong value and culture whereby men is superior than women. And because of this thought, man is superior than woman, woman is treated less than a cow. In India, some parts of it treated that way. Woman is treated less value than a cow. So God says, go into those villages and change how they think and how they look at women. Go into those villages and look at how they treat little girls. Some villages believe that girls are of no value, therefore, when they are born, and if they are a girl, they bury them alive. I was watching a video last night, contemplating if I want to show it to you. In China and in India, the three most cursed word is, it is girl. A girl. And there are villages whereby they hold it so strongly within them. But God breaks his heart to see villages value men more than women and treat women as nothing. Surely God has an opinion about that if he has made women in his image. And God calls his church and his people to step into those villages to change the texture. One of the work that YWAM does in the Amazon jungle in Brazil is that we go out to those tribal that's living in the Amazon jungle. One of the tribes that we went out to, the Zuruwaha tribe that I talked about yesterday, they have one cultural practice, and the practice is this. If your baby is born as a twin, the first one is real, the second one is a demon. You have to bury the second one alive. If you are born with a baby and the baby turns yellow or have fever, it has a spirit, especially when it turns yellow, you are to bury the baby alive. That's the cultural practice within there. So when YWAM went into those situations, into those missionary situations, teaching the gospel, the good news, is only one part of it. The bigger challenge of it is to change the way of thinking. And that's what Matthew 28 is about. It's about stepping into villages and kampong and look at where the social lives is all about and all the cultures and all the values within the culture. And where does it not like God? And God says, go into the world. Go into the kampongs and the district. Make disciples of kampongs and district. Immerse them in the fullness of who I am, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. How? By teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. So the book that you and I hold has the power to change communities. The book that you and I hold have the power to change the society. And I will expound on that much later on. And the third strand is called the poor and the needy. You can never step into nations without touching the poor and the needy. When you look through all the scriptures from Genesis through to Revelation, I do a course on social justice and God. And if you were to take out all the verses about social justice, about what God says about the poor, your Bible will not hold together. Because the Bible is full of scriptures about how we should treat those who are poor and needy, and what we should do with people who are suffering injustice. So when we look into the Great Commission, these are the three things that is woven together as one. Preaching the gospel to every individual person, going to the society and change the cultures and the thinking of the society, as well as going out there to look at the poor and the needy, and all three are woven together as one. And so, we talk about friendship with God, and where does it begin? It begins with the relationship with God, and we had a scripture on Psalms 25, verse 14, that talks about God shares his secrets with those who fear him. And I said to the church that God is always looking for people that he can have a kopi with, coffee chat. Not someone who is only interested to tell him the problems, but God is always looking for a church who will make time to hear his heart, his thoughts, and his dreams about the nations, about the future, and how he feels towards them. God is always looking for people. God is always looking for churches that he can have room and space amongst the church community. So I like what Pastor Barnabas said. Is it okay if one day that God were to show up here in this community here with a burden in his heart? That in the midst of the worship, that God interrupts. Can God interrupt us? Something that you need to think about. Can God interrupt us and say to us, can you give me this time? Let me talk to you. The burden of my heart. You know, God visits churches Sunday after Sunday and throughout the whole time, He's always with His people. His people have got tons of things to say to Him. And I'm sure all of us here, we do. We got lots of things that we want to say to God. But have you ever considered that God has lots of things to want to say to you and I? He has stuff in His heart and He wants to talk. He's just looking for people who will make time and room and space for Him to have a chat with us. Amos 3:7 says, "The sovereign Lord will not do anything without first revealing His plans to His servants, the prophets." Isaiah 46, verse 10 to 11, talks about God sees the world in the big picture form, and that God has got plans and desires, one step at a time. And in there, John does not look at his life and put him in the middle and say, "God, what is your plan for me, to bless me, to prosper me?" No, that's not the right question. The right question is, "God, what is your big picture, and where do I fit into the big picture? Where do I fit in the big picture?" So I asked John, what does he do? He told me that he's an interior designer. And I was thinking about interior designing. You know, John, I took a team. Some of them were interior designers, and we went to Chiang Rai in this particular home called the House of Union in Chiang Rai. And this guy, he was a tribal guy, and an American missionary came, found him when he was a kid, sponsored him through education, and he graduated in the university in Chiang Rai with a degree in English. He came to Singapore to do a discipleship training school with YWAM, and God spoke to him to return back to his people what he had received. So he went back to Chiang Rai, taught English in his university, and he found a burden, and he went up to the mountains, bring the children down, created a home for the children to receive education, and he connect the kids to the international community to come in there to help them. So I was one of those teams that went in there. But with me was a team member who designed space. His major specialist is in how to use space. And when he went to this orphanage, he saw all, it's not an orphanage, it's a children's home. He saw the amount of space that they have. We went into the kitchen, we began to discover something. A lot of the children fell sick because of the way they organized the kitchen. Because of the way they deal with raw food and cooked food, what the kind of utensils they begin to make, and also the space that they were using, they put all the raw meat and the raw vegetables side by side within there. So this guy, interior designer, space specialist, went in there and came up to me and says, "Joe, I feel that God wants me to use my gift to rework the kitchen." So we talked to the leader within there, and he says, "Yes, please." I didn't know how to do it. I knew there was a problem. I just didn't know how to do it. So for the whole trip, all we did was we redesigned the whole kitchen. That was our primary assignment, to redesign the whole kitchen, to sort things out, to put things in the proper order, and we handed it over to the team. 6 years, continuously, they kept up to the main standard within there. Up to now, we have left them, but they have gone on, keep going on. So what has happened is this, is that this particular designer began to discover that God has gifted me with this gift. And this gift can be deployed into the nations. And this gift could end up people maximizing what God has given to them and to free up the thing in such a manner whereby people can live healthily and move on from within there. So as we look into the Asia's map, God has plans and His heart's desire within this part of the world, and God wants to call people to use their giftings into this part of the world to contribute and to reveal His glory. The question is this: can God trust you? Can God trust you with this assignment? Can God trust you with a nation? Can God trust you with a work, and in there that you will steward it properly and that you will walk into the fullness of it and honor God with that? So the question was, is CMC, Christ Methodist Church, available and willing to be the friend of God? Yesterday, we worked on missions from Genesis to Revelation. And in that part of it, we discover that God blesses His people so that His people can be a blessing to the nations surrounding them. And that word, the Abrahamic covenant, has got to do with a cross-cultural element. And in other words, God has blessed all that He has given to me. I am to cross culture into another nation and bless other people. God didn't bless me just because He loves me. God blesses me because He loves the world. He loves the world and He wants to communicate who He is to the nations of the world. So as we look at that, what then is our response to God as our friend? Well, I say here, the obedience to God's call is our response to God's invitation who formed the nation and is constantly at work amongst them. Brothers and sisters, you and I need to know that God is in all the nations of the world. It's just that the world does not recognize Him. And God wants us to step into those nations that do not know Him, to use our bodies, use our skills, use our lives and our story to tell a story to the people groups there that do not know Him. So missions is our opportunity to practice John 3:16. Now, if you know John 3:16, let's say the verse together. Ready? Go. For God, that whosoever, that's right. But what is the principle behind John 3:16? The principle behind John 3:16 is for God so loved the world that He gave His best. For God so loved the world that He gave His best. That's what it is. And for God so loved the world, if God wants to give His best to Cambodia, who will He pick? He'll pick His church. His church is His expression. It's His only expression of His best to the nations. So out of what I've learned, I wrote a pledge for myself. And this helps me to focus. I'm a blessing. I'm a bridge. I'm a catalyst to the peoples of Asia. Through the love of God, I will embrace. I will pray. I will give of myself generously to others. I will rightly represent God's character. And I will lay down my rights to serve others. And I will love people with God's love. What does that mean? I'm a blessing. What does the blessing do? Well, the blessing adds to someone. The blessing contribute to someone that as a result of knowing you and interacting with you, that person is in a better position because of you. That's what a blessing does. What does the bridge do? Connects. Connects what to what? People to God, people to people, information to lack of information, lack of resources to resources, lack of technology to technology. So it connects. What does the catalyst do? Speeds up. Speeds up. There are many people out there in the nation that's trying their best to do something, but they're limited in their resources. So you come along, you call them up, you speed up the process so that they can keep on moving because of your contribution. That's what a catalyst does. But in here, I talk about through the love of God, I will embrace. Why embrace? Because you can never make an impact in someone else's life unless you get up close enough. You can never make an impact from a distance. If you really want to make an impact in someone's life, you need to get up close enough and embrace a culture, embrace a person, embrace an environment, and just take it in and love that person through the love of God. I will pray. Why? Because it's not dependent on my strength. I will give of myself generously to others. Why? It's not about money. It is about my time, my effort, my concentration to just give of myself generously to other people so that they may know who God is. Through the love, I will rightly represent God's character. Why? Because I can wrongly represent Him. I can wrongly represent Him. You know, very regularly we bring Singapore teams out into the nation. And one of the common things that you will find Singaporeans say is, how come they are not like us? You know, how we think the world live by our standard. Wow. Not like Singapore, yeah? Of course not like Singapore, because they're not Singapore. So we need to lay down some of our rights to what we think it is right. When I first went to China, this is back in 1999, this is in Kunming. If you go to Kunming, the people in Kunming, sometimes they like to spit. So I was in that time, there was an international arts festival just finished, and there was a signboard that has got the 10 commandments of the streets of Kunming. Commandment number 1, thou shalt not spit. The commandment number, thou shalt not speak loudly. So interesting, right? So I stood in front of this board to want to take a picture of that because it was very interesting. But this board is next to the roadside. And so as I was standing there, my friend was taking a picture of me. There were a lot of bicycles that were going by. And I heard somewhere in the distance, someone went, next thing I knew, on my feet. I was so offended, right? You're like, how can you spit on my feet? And it was not water, it was tick, tick, ting, no, that was on my feet. And so when you go into the restaurant, it's very common that you hear people go, gah, gah, gah. So I couldn't do it, I couldn't help it. Because at one time, I was interacting with this guy from Kunming, he's from Kunming City, and I just have to bring this up. And I asked him, why do Kunming people like to spit on the floor like this, you know? It's so unhygienic, not like Singapore, it's so unhygienic, right? And so he looked at me, he says, why not? I didn't know how to answer him. He asked me this question. Okay, you know, in the restaurants, they will also spit on the floor, yeah? So then I asked him, so he asked me this question. Is the floor clean or dirty? Dirty. Is the table clean or dirty? Clean. Is the food clean or dirty? Clean. Is my spit clean or dirty? Dirty. Then dirty things should go to the floor. I look at him. He's right. It's just that my preference is you don't spit on the floor. So he asked me, then where do you spit? Then I said, spit on tissue lah. Or they go to the toilet and spit or whatever, you know. And so he couldn't understand or appreciate that thing. So I began to realize that when we step into the nations, we step into the nation with a set of our preferences. And we think that the nation should live by our standard. In that we are to love people with the love of God. So when we look into the church and the missions to the world, what are we talking about, the church and the missions to the world? Well, when we look at the church does not exist in a building. The church exists in a society. Look at this framework. Every one of you here fit into at least one of these circles within there. You're either in the realm of the arts, beauty, you're realm in the business, provider, you're in the realm of communications, communicator, you're in the realm of the education, a teacher, or you're in the family, a father and a mother, you're in the government, a judge, or in the realm of the healthcare, science and technology, creator and healthcare. And so within that realm, every single one of these circles, God has a character. God has a role. In fact, if you were to read the whole Bible, if you take off the church lens, you put on the lens of an arts entertainment person, beauty, script writing, song, painting, sculpture, fashion designing, color matching, jewelry setting, architecture, construction. You put on these lenses, you read this book, you will find that the book is full of scriptures about arts entertainment. If you put on the lenses of a teacher and read this book, you will find that this book consists of everything about teaching. If you put on the lenses of a government, you'll find that the Bible is full of scriptures about how to govern a nation. This book that we have is a manual that God has given, not just for you and for me to be blessed, but for the nations to be transformed if you live by this book. The Bible is not just an ordinary book. It is a manual for the nations, a manual to build communities, a manual to reach out to the people. All we need to do is to wear the right pair of glasses to read this book. And so when we look into the Great Commission, we talk about what is the most practical way of unpacking the Great Commission into an action form. This is how the Great Commission looked like. Number one, everyone on earth has a right to hear and understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not just to hear, but to understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. Number two, everyone on earth has a right to have a Bible available on his or her own language. Whether people can read or cannot read. If they cannot read, then you need to do an oral Bible. There are many, many situations out there in the field whereby people have never been to school before, so they don't understand concepts. What then do you need to do? You need to do orality, oral. Just speaking the word of God in a manner that they can understand. You see, when you look into the gospel, it's interesting to note this, that Jesus never used scriptures publicly. He always used scriptures in a synagogue. When he's speaking in the public, what does he use? Parables. Stories. Why? Because stories relate to people. Therefore, when you're in the church, speak Christianese. We are very good at that. A1, Christianese. But when you're on the street, please don't speak Christianese. They don't understand what we're talking about. We need to speak parables and languages in a manner that they can understand. Number three, that all believers in the church have access to a fellowship for worship, for evangelizing, for discipleship, and for accountability. Number four, to have Christian education available for the children. Number five, to have the basic necessity for food, water, clothing, healthcare, and shelter. Number six, to lead a productive life of fulfillment spiritually, mentally, socially, emotionally, and physically. This is the Great Commission unpacked in a most practical way, and every single one of us can participate in at least one of these. Every one of us, we can. This is how missions looks like. And as you embark this year into the nations, don't just think of preaching the gospel in an environment. No, think beyond that. Think the Matthew 28, whereby if you cannot speak, how do you then speak the gospel through your actions? Through what you do within that. And God is able to do that. I'd like to share some stories with you. This is Lugule. Luguhu. I've been to many churches to speak, but this is the first church in the first service I met someone who'd been to this lake. This Luguhu lives a people group called Mosuoju. Mosuoju is currently now the only matriarchal kingdom in the world. It's a tribe whereby there's no marriage. There's no marriage. Absolutely no marriage. It's a tribe whereby the woman holds the key to all authority. The woman builds the house. The woman builds the road. The woman do farming. The woman climb the mountain and chop trees and bring them into branches and carry on their back, like 60 kilo and walking down the slope of the mountains. I was there, I saw all these things. What do the men do? Sleep, play chess, dance, drink, and sing music. Want to go? Yeah. Then when a woman wants to give birth, the woman will go to the square in the middle of the night, in the night time, in the evening time. So I want to show you the lake. So this is the lake. This is the lake. It's beautiful. It's 2,800 meters above sea level. So the woman will go to the square, and the square is somewhere around here, okay, on this block here on the left side, on the bottom left side. And they'll go to the square, and the men will be dancing around a campfire. The woman will chip into the dance, and they will dance together with them. So by now, everybody's high, because they're drinking. And then the woman will shake hands with some of the men. She goes back home. The men will come. And the men will bring their guitar, their music, and they will sing. And the woman has a room called Asia Fang. This room has only one light. It's a lantern and it's red in color. The concept of Ang Ting came from this tribe. That's the only tribe in the world that has this thing called the Ang Ting. I know Amsterdam also have the Ang Ting, but this Ang Ting is totally pure and it's tribal situation. So when they light it up, the men will come and the men will sing. She will pick one man, come into him, have sex with him. The next day, the man leaves. She's pregnant. She gives birth to a child. The child carries a family name and she continues. Then she goes out again. She wants to mate again. She brings in another man. So there's no marriage in this tribe. And after she does that a couple of times, by the time when she hit about 50 or 60 years old, she doesn't want to do this anymore. That man also become 50, 60. She will go out to the street and look at one of those men that she has slept before, bring him into the house, look after him until he dies. This is how this tribe lives. YOM has been trying to step into this tribe to do missions work amongst them. We failed terribly. I was there at the turn of the millennium in 1999 to year 2000. Remember the Y2K thing? Everybody in the world think that Jesus is going to come back on the year 2000, remember? Yeah, remember, you buy rice and you buy salt and you keep it just in case Jesus come back, then there's no more, right? So I was on this lake. I was on this lake And we were praying for this particular leg. I remember we were crying out to God and praying for this leg and asking God to do His miraculous work amongst these more so tribal people within there. And it was just so difficult. 10 years later, I was in Tibet. I was teaching in Tibet in the DTS school, and in my class were two students from this leg. And I thought, wow, you mean Christianity has come to amongst the leg? She says, yes. I said, how so? He said, there are about 100 of us now on this lake that have come to Christ. I said, wow, this is incredible. A church is born. How did Christianity enter into your lake? She says, by a family who came and taught in our school. It was basically a family, but because of this lake that becomes so popular, many, many men go to this lake. Because of that, they have been spreading HIV. This tribe is a dying tribe right now in China. And a lot of men will go to this lake, and because of tourism, they needed to be educated. So a family, a missionary family, went to this lake and began to teach them. And when they looked at this family, they saw something that they yearned for, but they never had it before. What is that? Marriage. A father in a house. And it was through that situation that the missionary family became a testimony to this lake that it's not wrong to get married. They have never been told that it's not wrong to be married. They thought it was a curse to be married. And so in the process, right now, this church exists on this lake. There are about 100 believers, totally 100% indigenous amongst the people living there. So when you look into education, many of us here, you might be in the education field. One of the most unique things that Singapore has is our Christian public schools. Our Christian schools in Singapore are not private. Only one or two are private, but most of our schools are public schools. But because of that, it has impacted our nation in such a powerful and drastic way. Do you know that it is not like this anywhere else in the world? Everywhere else in the world, Christian schools are private and they're struggling to survive. Singapore has this privilege. But have you ever considered that this privilege is meant to be taken out into the nations and to be given to other people who never had a chance to be educated in that way? I want to show you, I cannot because it's about 12 o'clock. I want to tell you a story. This is an important story because I know that part of your outreach is here in Singapore. Some of you have heard me talk about this 2 years ago, about Geylang and about some of our street work in Geylang. Some of you were involved, some of you contributed towards that. Thank you very much. The work continues. Our work in amongst the street walkers continues right now. We have about eight ladies that come to our center on a regular basis, and they're all, and so their children. We have a children's club, but all our kids are children of the prostitutes. And right now, we have extended towards the men. Some of them are the husbands that we are working with right now. So Tema Village continues. And then we have this ministry called the Trolley Ministry, whereby we go out to the streets amongst the homeless people. In the past, we have always been giving out food. We have stopped giving out food because we are now moving into a stage called development and not just giving aid. We realize that giving aid sometimes doesn't help a person. When a person can do something to get food, stop doing something to get food instead of looking to you to get food, then your charity have just become very dangerous for them. You rob them, we rob them from the ability to help themselves. So we are now entering into a stage whereby we work on development with some of the people in the trolley ministry. But this is what I want to share with you. 2 years ago when I came to you, that was 2015 when I came to you, I was telling you stories about what God was doing in our midst there. But 2015 was also Singapore's Jubilee year. And in our Jubilee year, God was doing a lot of work amongst us. And I think I shared this with you, but the time when I shared it with you was before we had this Jubilee Carnival. I talked to you about God wanting to celebrate Singapore's 50th party here in Singapore in Geylang. And I told you about a plot of land next to Aljunied MRT, the empty plot of land that God wanted to hold a party. And I remember telling you, I'm not sure if I did, but I remember telling you that we held out an empty piece of paper when we asked God, God, if you were to hold a party in this empty plot of land next to Geylang Methodist Church, what do you want to have in this party for the community in Geylang? Number one, haircut. Number two, massage. Number three, pedicure and manicure. Number four, health care checks. Number five, games for the children. Number six, photography with printing on the spot. Number seven, food for everyone. And number eight, a departmental store that gives away brand new things. I'm here to report to you. I remember at that time, we only had 10 weeks to set this up. I spoke 25 services in 10 weeks. I've never done it before. I will never do it again. And in that 10 weeks, apart from me, some other my colleagues also went out to churches to speak. 600 volunteers signed up from about 30 over churches, contributed $120,000 for this party. When we went out to the street, we invited close to 3,000 to 4,000 people, but the carnival was only prepared for 2,000 people. In total, 1,800 people showed up. The advocate was that the church would hold a service out in the open to do worship without singing. Listening to a sermon without a preacher and giving an offering without giving money. Here's what happened. In the midst of the 1,008 that came, all of them came from Geylang community as well as construction sites all across Singapore. One of our highlights was an MP, member of the parliament, showed up without announcing. And she brought a constituent of 80 people from the one-room flat and came and enjoyed the whole thing. Our biggest highlight was the PIM that showed up. And the PIM brought the whole brothel on Saturday morning and said, our ladies are very tired. Would you serve them? Question, will Jesus serve them? Yes, without a doubt. So this is what we did. We trimmed the nails of the homeless people and of the street walkers. This group of young people came from Church of Our Savior. 300 youth signed up to do pedicure. They went to learn how to trim nails. And one of them was trimming the nail of a homeless uncle. This homeless uncle had not trimmed his nail for a long time. So his toenail very big, very long, very deep, full of mud. You put a seed, it can grow and bear fruit. And so as he was cleaning his feet, he was like, he couldn't handle it anymore. This boy, bless his heart. He couldn't handle the smell and the sight. He said, uncle, why you don't wash your feet? Uncle, why you don't trim your nail? Uncle, this is very bad for you, you know? So he was ranting non-stop. Uncle, 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 uncle. By the time he finished talking, uncle speaks. Uncle says, a boy, uncle cannot bend. He broke down and he wept. He wept and he wept. And there was at a point in time whereby his tears washed his feet. And in that moment, he saw the gospel happen to him. It was as if that he heard a preacher speaking to him, Jesus speaking to him, and he had a major conversion as he trims the nails of this uncle. Trimming hair for someone, doing massage for someone within there. Worship without singing. This is how worship can look like. A sermon without a preacher. Basically paying attention to people, listening to people, listening to what's going on in their lives and in their heart, and just wanting to listen to God as they listen to the stories of the people along the street. What does it mean to give offering without giving money? Not just about giving things, that we can. Not just about serving food, that we can. Not just about setting up cures, that we can and we should keep on doing. But more than that, it's about giving attention. Do you know what is the one thing that Singaporeans need to learn to do when we talk about domestic helpers, construction workers, and people who are broken? Is to give your attention. attention. Just give your attention as a gift to the people surrounding us. So as you explore missions into the nations or missions on the streets, I have been advocating all across Singapore that churches in Singapore will set aside a weekend to hold a church service on the streets of Singapore. You know, on the weekend, Kallang River looked very different. On the weekend, Orchard Road, Chinatown, and all these places looks very different. So we sing here, and we claim that God is in our midst. And we say that God is here. Do you know how God looks like on the streets? Do you know how God smells like on the street? Do you know how God will visualize himself on the street? We have a lot to learn. We have a lot to learn. We box ourselves in and we claim that God is here. While he is true that God is here in our midst, but God is also out there. The point is, do we know how God looks like on the streets and in the nations and amongst the slum areas and in the homes? So the advocate is to call the churches together in small groups of 6 to 10 to go to where the least of our society is gathered. So whether it's here in Singapore or out there in the nations, in this year, 2017, will Christ Methodist Church respond to God's invitation to say, come and meet me on the streets here in Singapore and all across the nations? So as we look at Singapore being the Antioch of Asia, God has blessed our nation with so much. For what? Not just because he loves us. He has blessed us so that Singapore will become a blessing to the nations of the world. I know you have got 6 nations hung here on the flag. On closing, I would like you to look at this map. Please don't close your eyes. I'm going to pray, but please don't close your eyes. Please don't look at me. Just look at the map. Father, we thank you for blessing Singapore with such wealth. We were nothing, we were no one. On our 50th year, we celebrate all that you have done in our lives, and Singapore rejoices at the sound of who you are. But God, you didn't bless us just for ourselves. You blessed us so that Singapore may be a blessing to the nations. So as we look at this Asia's map, is there a nation that is so dear to you, that is so concerned in your heart, that you want to share it with us individually? Look at the map and ask God, Lord, is there a nation that you want me to focus on? By that, I don't mean to go. I mean just let God highlight a country to you. Let God highlight a region to you. Let God highlight a demographic to you. God might say, the children of Asia. God might say, the slums of Asia. God might say, the tribes in the mountains of Asia. Look at the map. Look at the map. God has things in his heart that he's longing to have a chat with you about. Now my question is, can God trust you? I know we have always been talking about trusting God. I'm going to flip the question behind. Around. Can God trust you with a burden of his heart? And the final question is, are you available and are you willing to be a channel of blessing to the nations, communities, families, and individuals? I can't help it, please forgive me, but to realize that Christ Methodist Church is a middle and upper income church. You are. And I rejoice with you over the blessings that God has poured into your lives. My prayer for you is that the blessings that God has given to you will not become your stumbling block. Something is wrong with this picture if the blessings of God that is poured into your life becomes a stumbling block. No. It's never meant to be intended that way. God didn't bless us in such a manner that we become, that blessing becomes a stumbling block. God's intention is that through us, the communities all across Singapore and the nations will be blessed because of His blessings upon our lives. So I pray for you and I pray over you that as God has clicked something in this church, that you will not be a container, but you will be a funnel. You will be a funnel. For those of you who are in Christ Methodist Church, before you went through your first or your second renovation, remember those days where church was non-aircon? How many of you were Christians when church was non-aircon? You go to church now. You remember what church service was like? Very hot, right? And very loud. And this neighborhood here could hear you. Yeah? If they kepo enough, they peep, they can see what's going on inside the church. Right? And then God bless us. What do? We aircon ourselves, we soundproof ourselves, and we box ourselves in. My church is the same. My church has windows. You know what we do? We curtain it up. Something is wrong in the picture. No other religion in Singapore closes its doors from Monday through to Friday, except the church. Every other religion opens its door to the public. We shut ourselves in. Something is wrong with this picture. Surely God wants to break open and be out there. Please hear my heart. Hear my heart. I think God longs to be revealed on the streets. God longs to be revealed amongst the broken. He pleads with the church that you will not be afraid of darkness. YRM, a month ago, we had our Christmas party. We asked God where we should hold our Christmas party. And the Lord says, hold it outdoors. So a team went out to the streets and prayed for 3 weeks, asking God where we should hold our party. We came across Lorong 14, where the brothels are. We met one of the pimp who brought his brothel to our carnival. He asked us, why are you guys walking around here? And our leader said, we are looking for a place to hold our Christmas party. And you know what he says? Hold it at my brothel. And that's what we did. On the 18th of December, we met outside the brothel, set up a table with the dinner of the Christmas. We had Christmas carols outside the brothel. Brothers and sisters, don't be afraid of darkness. You know we are so scared to go to Geylang. Something is wrong. The church is afraid of darkness. The pimp came and asked one of our team members, hey, how come the church never come? We've been here for business for so long. We know that church always go to Orchard Road during Christmas time, but no one came. We short of telling them that we are so scared of you. Surely, 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 God wants to be known amongst the nations. And I sense very strongly, Christ Methodist Church, you need to listen to the cry of the Heavenly Father. He's speaking very loud and very clear. I sense this very loud and clear. Christ Methodist Church, come out. Come out. Come out.